Councillor Kenny, over on councilling. I find it difficult that when we have these local development plans, and local planning committee turn down applications that are made, that then the Department of Communities override it, as they have worked through the planning inspectorate in Bristol. What is the point of having these local neighbourhood plans if it's, they're just going to override over and override my thought shop?
John Prescott's the county.
Irrespective of who set it up, it's not about the planning, is it?
I'm just trying to give a response to that. Yes, we do have the neighbourhood plans, whereas they haven't taken planning consideration, they have to be taken into account. The planning process, as it's organised in this country, means that an applicant can make an application, a local authority has to determine that, and then if that application is refused, there's an automatic right to appeal that they have withdrawn from the planning inspector in Bristol. A planning inspector will then effectively review the case and come to their view, which is then binding on the council. That's just the process as it is. I know that causes issues around decisions that are taken, but unfortunately that's just the process we have to work with.
So that's a question. I agree with what you said, I'm not trying to stop this because, I think it's wrong and so on. Do you know these planning inspectors that come to do the inspection? Do it myself, I think, actually, they all come from Bristol or the old, all over the country, and are the local, so they know what's going on in the locality. Well, there you go.
The planning inspectors work for the inspector that is based in Bristol.
Yeah.
But they do work remotely, around the country. Some have knowledge of an area, some don't. It just depends who the planning inspector allocates the case to. What they will do in most circumstances, there's two different ways of doing it. One is by written representations, which is just all a paper-based view by the inspector. In other cases, they will actually come up and have a look at the site.
I agree, and I think we are to use the system. We could, if we had inspectors who lived in the area or in the close locality and knew what was going on, they'd make a better informed decision. And just like to make a decision, something's happening in Scotland, Scotland, or Turkey, we'll have to deal with what's going on there. And they say,
they don't listen to your
co-residents,
I'm sure, just write your shop. I mean, the one in particular in Birkenhead, the whole planning committee. In fact, I was here and remember Councillor Lewis saying that it was getting my phone back to the defensive times, what they were trying to do there. But we're nothing.
Thank you. I forgot Chris. Thank you, Christine.
Given all the changes and since an awful lot of work going on just now in the planning department and what the new ferry and everything else that's happened. I'm just reading through, again, quickly reading through this letter. There's a section here that says 2012, where more recently companies led to 1,315 new dwellers on site under construction in April compared to 2016. Which means that obviously there's more applications coming into planning and that stuff. I'm just wondering whether that as a council we've put enough resources into the planning department to allow staff there to deal with all this increase in activity.
Just in terms of responding to that, it is encouraging that more properties are now being built. Mm-hmm. It will, and that's moving in the right direction. The volume of applications is high, but we are seeing quite a number of larger applications, rather than lots of small ones. In terms of the capacity within the planning department, just from a professional officer's point of view, I'm not making any political points here at all, but from a professional officer's point of view, we have resources to deal with the volume of work at the moment. But just recently, you may be aware that the government increased the planning fees nationally by 20%, on the basis that that additional 20% would be invested in the planning service, so local authorities could have more resources to process applications more quickly. And in terms of Wimmer, we are now currently looking at those additional costs that we can afford from that increased income. That income is roughly, on current income levels, about £240,000 a year. So we will be reinvesting that back into the service to provide more senior planning officers and planning officers to be able to deal with the application. So it will help us considerably in terms of the capacity that we currently have.
Thank you,
Christina.
The next to last page, halfway down, the copy of the local development scheme. Is that this? It says the copy of the amended local development scheme approved on 21st December 2017 is attached to your third major. Is that this one?
Right.
And on the inspectorate, you know how in planning, you can only, planning committee can only review on planning grounds. Can the inspectorate only find on certain grounds? Because if that's the case, I can't see why being local would make any difference. Because if you've got a set of guidelines to follow, then you just apply those guidelines to the situation in front of you.
He
could be
in
out
of
Mongolia
and
take
any
business. Yes, in terms of just responding to that, in terms of planning, there are planning policies and there's guidance on things, but as members will be aware, each application has to be judged on its merit, and there's a judgment and a weighing of certain considerations, because there's different criteria planning considerations. So that is why you get a situation where, for example, from our professional officer's view, we may decide that we couldn't support an application and refuse it, but of course there being planning inspectors in Bristol, they may weigh those considerations slightly differently to us, and that's why they come out in terms of approvals. It all has to be done on material planning considerations. So that's a level playing field from that perspective, but it's judging what weight you give to various aspects of each individual planning application. And that's why it's more of a judgment, it's not a precise sort of mathematical
So practically,
it
doesn't matter if you go
to
local area, local just as anybody on the planning committee, Stuart could be moved, if it was legal, to Southampton, and he would, the basic rules of planning would apply in that planning committee the same.
Under those circumstances, yes, they tend to apply, you know, the policies that apply in the local authority area. There's some differences on those, but the general principles are the same.
Yeah.
So yes, in some senses, you could do that role from anywhere in the country, on any application, in any local authority area. However, there is also development. So at times, actually having local knowledge of an area can also be of benefit, because, you know, with us working here, we can understand certain things about certain things. Consideration. Somebody coming into the area may not have that same local knowledge as we do. So, you know, it's just one of those things. But the way the system works at the moment is how it's set up nationally. And we've lobbied and made a number of comments over the years about that. But, you know, at the moment, that is the system we work within.
Thank you.
Thanks. Just go back to the issue of the local plan. In the letter from the Secretary of State on the 16th of November, the Secretary of State, in his penultimate paragraph, asks for two things from the Council. He asks for an outline of any exceptional circumstances by today which justify the failure of World Council to produce a local plan, and also, as well as that, to hear any measures the authority has taken. The letter that we've had tonight outlines the measures that is taking or will be taking to accelerate the plans. The letter that we've had tonight doesn't answer that first point in terms of the exceptional circumstances that we think have allowed Wirral to not comply with the Act of 2004. I'm not convinced the Secretary of State and the Department will be convinced by this letter itself as answering that first part of the request.
I just may respond through the chair to that. The Leader of the Council has sought to respond specifically to the Secretary of State's letter. In that response, there are reasons given for the delays in the plan process around some of these circumstances. For example, abolition of regional spatial strategy, also things to do with housing needs and a range of other things. There's no definition in terms of what an exceptional circumstance actually is, but in terms of the letter and what we've set out, the Leader's view is that that does respond positively to the Secretary of State's letter. We have had acknowledgement from the Secretary of State today that he's received this, and they will contact us again when he's had an opportunity to consider it. But we are in touch from an officer perspective with the civil servants who are dealing with this matter and briefing the Minister. So if they don't feel that there is sufficient information at a particular point or they need further information, then they are in touch requesting that from us and working it on that basis.
Thank you.
Just a brief follow-up on that. It seems like well, exceptional means something that everyone else hasn't had. So there's a general reasoning, the delay that everyone will experience. There's an exception. It's an exception to where I think that's where I saw the same point. There's nothing that seems to pertain to something exceptional that's happened on the world that's particularly affected our plan. I think that's a comment to the
plan. Yeah, and just in quick response to that, again, we have tried to set out, we're just trying to set out and deal those exceptional circumstances. Some of the issues do apply to other authorities as well as ourselves, so they would be unique. But when you look on sort of page 3 of the letter, where it's been set out there, issues around national household projections and the delays that have been there, and other considerations, the view was that those are the exceptional circumstances that put us in the position where we currently are now. What the letter also tries to demonstrate, though, is that we now have a timetable for moving forward. We've outlined the detailed work programme that involves. The Leader, in his letter, has committed to that timescale and meeting those particular dates, and also agreed to put additional resources into the forward planning team to help with that process and keep on that timeline. It's our view as officers that the timeline that is now set out is the shortest possible time to reach the plan adoption stage, and that legally, with all the processes that we have to go through, you wouldn't be able to do it any quicker. So I think, hopefully next week, the weeks now, there's further discussions with the department around what we should take to see where we go from there.
Just to come back to the last time we met about this, all this went out, I think the reason is that the last time were about political decisions that were made.
Yes.
You didn't seem to mention anything to me about that.
In terms of the discussion that we had last time, I think I identified that there were a number of reasons why the plan had been delayed, and one of those was indeed obviously the decision-making process, taking time to consult with people and to cover those points. So, our view is that those things have been covered both in the report to you there, as you go through the timeline, you see some of those things where decisions have been made, and so on, and also just generally covered in the letter.
Okay, thank you.
grateful to have sat through the previous discussion, which was informing me better on some issues than I was previously, having read the letter from the Secretary of State about accelerating the planned publication, which is a point raised in the previous debate, and having read the timetable, and I'm hopeful that the timetable will allow the kind of detailed work we need to get done on the various issues, either to carefully identify sites or to reserve sites or make a really detailed judgment on where we go with sites. But my notice of motion, it was written around at the time the Secretary of State issued his letter, and I particularly concentrated on the greater clarity on the evidence base, and I also raised the issue of resources, staff resources, to speed up the local plan making process. Because having read other councils' work on the infrastructure levy, I had worked my way through not only our reports, the reports to Cheshire and Knowsley and Sefton and St. Helens. St. Helens isn't proposing to use the CIL at the moment. And I was very conscious that it needs to be dealt with when they bring a CIL in. For instance, a report from the inspectorate on Cheshire West, the one called QAP for the time being, for shortness. That report started from a hearing in September 2006. The further hearings in December 2016, hearings in December 2016 and March 2017, and then a final report in June 2017, purely on the issue of the community infrastructure levy. And during that time, they went through sites, they had representations from developers, they looked at different costs for developing brownfield and open sites, and they divided Cheshire West into a series of zones. Rather very much like our report that came out, if I get the date right, get to our cabinet in 2015. So I appreciate it, not an easy process. Then I began to look at what are the gains from the process and whether they're overstated. In the case of Cheshire's report, in June, the inspector accepted that Cheshire could get between 28.5 million and 43.9 million between now and 2030. Though that does include retail loans. And when I look at some of Sefton's reports, Sefton's committee report, cabinet report last September, recognised they need to spend £50,000 on preparing a report for CIL, but they anticipated that they would get £830,000 a year, that would cost them £40,000 admin to achieve it. So other councils have looked at CIL, and the relationship I've been trying to get right is the relationship between 106, which applies to particular sites in the immediate neighbourhood, perhaps things specifically arising from that development, and the general community impact of development. I just refer back to CIL in Sefton, where they said they might get £10 million in their area by 2030. So looking more closely at schemes just over the border, because we appreciate living down the furthest part of the borough away from our town hall, I look at what goes on in Elsie Court. And the development of Barrett Homes on Sutton Way of 140 homes, they were required to produce £346,400 for Whitby High School. And the development of Red Road of 193 dwellings out at Dunkirk, they were expected to provide £295,000 for educational purposes, £48,000 towards the GP surgery, and £145,000 to open space playing pictures. Now again, I'm trying to look at what is 106, what is CIL. Because the developer is going to look at what is required to cough up for various things and what his costs are. Our report in January 2015, I just quote one paragraph of the rules, because we divided ourselves into four zones. There was study of housing, apartments, retail, and non-food retail, and officers made a judgment at that time. And they said, until the final viability study report is received, it will not be possible to speculate on what the final potential CIL charging rates for rural could be. However, they said, the evidence from the baseline report suggests that the introduction of a CIL charge is unlikely to put overall levels of development at risk in many parts of the borough. So that's a direct from our offices.
So we're trying to wait. Can I ask you to wind up?
Yes, I'll be brief. Finally, to come up there, the government in December said it wanted to speed up the process for creating CILs, and that was included in the newsletter, the Chief Planner's newsletter of December 2017, which I think officers will be familiar with. A council like Khashoggi knows the report on CIL and how they propose to achieve it, and there's 80 pages of diagrams, maps and calculations and zones, but this is the kind of work that we'll need to put in train to fit in with whatever timetable we have, to fit in with whatever the Secretary of State decides, and how we might proceed in the future. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Councillor.
Thanks, Chair. I think the key issue is obviously we're not necessarily got the development beaten down on door in various places. So you know we can't afford to put people on certain developers, some I've spoken to recently, want us to put infrastructure in before they even will start you know building. So you know it might be the case that we want developers to hurry up and build. We don't want to put any barriers in their way. Whether it's a way to discourage people from building in certain parts of the world, encourage other areas, but there are other tools to do that. So I suppose it's another tool in the back, but it depends on how much work it is to create this extra plan and how much of a benefit it's going to be for the world. I can see how it works in different parts of the country where they're inundated with investment, but there's a balance to be struck as you can think as councillor will first mention.
Steve?
Yeah, question and comment really. If previous notice of motion puts onus on sort of housing developments, would this then be matched against whether they could meet the affordable housing criteria and or this levy or you know a development tax, whatever you want to call it, CIL. And then so the two sort of issues are probably running, not running simultaneously because I know it's different type of legislation, but my view would be that at the moment we need to look at the horizon, and I think if anyone needs to know how competitive the world is outside there today, Marks and Spencer's closure in Birkenhead reminds us that you know we are in seeking developers to come into certain areas in town rather than frightening them away. I'm not saying this will frighten them away because it's our legitimate right, and as the RSG will go in 2020. We have to find another source of income, and this may well be a reliable or a source of income that we want to take opportunity of. But again, it would be sort of horses for courses where the application was and what we were to gain on. I've sat on committees in this place where we've used the £30,000 a job rule, where we've given them a grant to come and develop a business within this authority. And many people remember those committee meetings. So we've actually, and other borders will be doing that. So again, my view is that it's to be looked at simultaneously with the plan that's going through now. We now have the timetable for the plan. And I draw the last attention to the last line of the notice of motion. Okay, so it says, accordingly, the request committee allocates sufficient resources to speed up the local plan. We now have a plan. Put the plan together and make that happen. And I believe that part of any local plan will look at this piece of legislation. But it's the first time I've seen in any budget resolution from any of the parties around this table that we have proposed extra investments in the planning departments or that type of thing. And touching on resources are an issue for this authority. This authority is being savaged by the government and people like Sajid Javid, who are part of that draconian austerity government that has ridden the